Hi, welcome to this webinar on deep learning. My name is Vivek Singhal. I am the co-founder and chief data scientist with CellStrat. So we are an AI startup out of India, based in Bengaluru and New Delhi. We conduct AI research and provide AI training programs. So this webinar is part of our evangelism series around AI, machine learning, and deep learning. And our group is called Disrupt 4.0, through which you found this webinar on meetup.com. Okay, so let's get started here. So just a plug on our startup, CellStrat. We are an AI startup, and we are involved in cutting edge research on state of the art AI and machine learning. And we are developing a lot of projects in this space, as well as some products in this space. We have about 100 AI researchers, primarily in Bengaluru, India, but some of them are spread around across the world. So we have members and students from across the world. But yes, bulk of our community is based in Bengaluru, India. We have an AI lab here, and we meet every Saturday, and our remote members join through online channel every Saturday. Okay. We also conduct lots of webinars of this nature, which you'll find on our meetup page. Okay, so our objective is to create a world-class AI research environment. So this is me, your speaker for today. I was based in the US for 16 years. Originally, I'm from India. I have worked with AT&T in my last job in the US before I came back into India in 2012. My job in India was with IBM as a director of solution architecture team. And in the last 5 years, I've been doing multiple startups, LV Ply, Sales Globe, Lockwell. This CellStrat is my most recent startup, which we started 3 years back, me and my co-founder. And here we engage in AI training and AI research. Our objective is to disrupt with power of advanced artificial intelligence, okay? I'm personally a data scientist, and I work in lots of algorithms, and we produce a lot of content and research. Some of it you'll find on our meetup page. Okay, so our agenda for today will be, I'll introduce you what is deep learning, what are artificial neural networks, and in the end, second part of this webinar, I'll be introducing what kind of training programs we have and what do we do in our AI research lab, and demonstrate some of our projects as well. Okay. Audience, you can ask me questions via the Q&A window. I see a question here. Let me see. Is there any specific way to enable the audio? So you can find some of our content on a research blog on our website, and we have trained a lot of people. We also work with other companies like Simply Learn or Manipal Education Group for training folks in AI and machine learning. Okay, let's continue. So let's get to our topic for the day, which is introduction to deep learning. Okay, so let me start by defining what is AI. So I'll use a digital pen here. Let me choose my favorite color, which is blue. And what is AI? AI is basically, in the simplest of terms, is inculcating intelligence in machines, simulating human intelligence. So if machines can do predictive intelligence just like humans, we call it artificial intelligence, okay? Right? And the applications and examples are robotics, computer vision, right? Image recognition, text analysis, data mining, self-driving cars. AI is used in all kinds of industries like e-commerce, retail, gaming, manufacturing, shipping, security, public sector, agriculture, you name it. Banking, credit scoring, fraud detection, natural language processing. Many of us might have tried the Amazon Alexa chatbot or Microsoft Cortana or even Apple Siri, right? So you can talk to these NLP chatbots and they will give you an intelligent answer. And they are also integrated with services like Uber, for example, when you want to order an Uber cab or want to order food from an online food delivery company. Okay, let's continue here. The figure is showing IBM Watson robot, which you'll typically find in IBM conferences. So IBM Watson is one of the popular AI platforms. Okay. I'm not a spokesperson for IBM. My only connection with IBM is I have worked in IBM for 2 years, but I'm by no means any spokesperson of IBM. Okay. So IBM Watson is one of the popular platforms, and so are other stacks from Google, Facebook, Amazon, Microsoft, and so on. Okay. Now let's look at machine learning. So what is machine learning? Machine learning is a branch or field of AI, and machine learning refers to those data science algorithms which allow us to train AI. Okay. So machines learn by observing current data, and the current data could look something of this nature, right? It's always about X and Y, or mostly it's about X and Y. So X is the input information, Y is the output decision. Okay. For example, what will be the price of Microsoft stock tomorrow? So X would refer to all the factors which influence the stock price of Microsoft, right? And Y would be the price of Microsoft share or stock price tomorrow, right? So we need input data, which is we refer to as the X factor, and we need the Y information, which we refer to as the output value. Okay. And for example, another example is what is contained in an image. The image is the X, and Y, what is contained in the image. Does an image contain a cat, a dog, a mouse, or something else, right? So the image itself is the X vector. Y is the label, the class of that image, okay, what it contains. So here in machine learning, we build algorithms that allow computers to learn to perform tasks. For example, predicting stock prices, or predicting what is contained in an image, right? Or predicting house prices, and so on, or predicting what is meant by speech or text. So here we are not programming it explicitly. That is a difference from traditional data analytics. In machine learning, we are training the model, and we are discovering the relationship between X and Y by feeding it existing data. So let's say I will have 1,000 samples. If I'm trying to do house price prediction, I'll have 1,000 samples, for example, 1,000 house prices along with the features which influence the house price. What are the features which influence house price? The area of the house. Let's assume there are two features, and the size of the house, right? The two features influence the house price, area of the house and size of the house. So this is called X1. This is X2. And what is the price of the houses? The price of the house is simply Y. So our objective statement is to find or reverse engineer the relationship between X and Y. So we are trying to find the ideal weights W1 and W2, right? So once I find the ideal weights W1 and W2, I can, this is called the trained algorithm or the trained model. Once the ideal weights W1, W2 have been found, by observing historical house prices, and then using this equation, I can predict Y. I can predict Y for any new house. Okay, I can predict Y for any new house using this learned equation. So this equation is called the model or the algorithm. Okay, so this is the equation, is the output of my machine learning training process. This is what we mean by machine learning. In traditional data analytics, you would be hard coding this equation because your product manager has given you the form of this equation. In machine learning, we are only given 1,000 house price samples along with their area and size, historical house prices. We have to find the equation. So difference between traditional data analytics and machine learning is we have to find the equation versus we already know the equation. Okay. So this is why this is called predictive intelligence, and we are able to predict future house prices using this learned equation. And now my machine is intelligent, my system is intelligent because it can predict the future house price for any new house which gets built. And this is how we make machines intelligent. Okay, this is same as training a child. When a human child is born, they learn by observing the environment. Okay. So same way, by observing historical data, we train a machine to predict future predictions. All right. So this is called as machine learning. It's a branch of AI, and it simply refers to set of data science algorithms like regression, decision trees, or classification with which we can train AI. Okay. if you have any questions, you can ask me via the Q&A window. Otherwise, I'll just keep moving forward. So now let's come to deep learning, our topic for the day. So what is deep learning? It's a specialized form of machine learning. Okay, it is machine learning only, but it's a more specialized form of it. Here we use networks of interconnected computation units called neurons. So you can see in the infographic on the right, these are a lot of computation units. These circles, we call them as neurons. And these we are inspired with from the neural network of the human brain. So human brain also has these kind of interconnected neuron structures. So there we call it biological neuron. Here we call it artificial neurons, and hence the term artificial neural networks. Okay. These are useful for more complex applications like image processing or speech recognition. Okay. They are useful for more complex applications like detecting what is contained in an image or understanding the intent of speech, right? Or even generating speech from text and so on. Or even in driverless cars or healthcare radiology or stock market predictions or time series modeling. So they are like zillions of applications. So as you can see here, we are using these a complex structure of interconnected computation units. So instead of having one computation unit where I am trying to find ideal weights, right? I'm trying to find ideal weights W1, W2, and so on. Here I have multiple computation units. These are my input pixels. So what are the input for an image recognition problem? It is the pixels, because each picture has pixels, right? If you know your digital graphics or computer graphics, a digital picture is made of pixels. Each picture has something called RGB value, right? A degree of red, degree of green, and degree of blue, correct? So by combining the RGB value, we get the final pixel color, and these pixels are segregated into a vector and fed into a neural network. So if there were like a million pixels, there'll be million input neurons here. Okay, these are called input neurons, the first layer. Then we compute the next neural values. So Y1, Y2, and Y3. Okay, and then we compute the next layer. Y3 dash, Y1 dash. So like that, instead of having just one Y, now we have Y at each neural layer. Okay. So this allows me to discover more complex features about my data. So in this case of object detection in image, the first hidden layer might detect edges. Like this is an edge, this is an edge, this is an edge, this is an edge, even this is an edge, right? The second hidden layer will combine the edges and detect corners and contours. Like this is a corner, right? Is a corner, right? And this is a corner, this is a corner, and so on. This is a corner. And the third hidden layer will detect the object parts, like the eye, the nose, right? The mouth, and the complete head, and so on. And the final output neural layer will identify finally what is contained in this image. Is it a car, person, or an animal? So there are three possible classes we have provided here. Okay, so there are three possible output labels. So it could be a car, person, or an animal. So we assume there are only three possible objects contained in an image. And so our model will learn how to predict the object in an image for a new image by looking at historical images and the output label. So I will have 1,000 such images provided to me. In case of each image, I will have an output class label. The class label will say whether this is car, it's a person, or an animal. So I have 1,000 images provided to me, for example, and there will be an output label attached to each image, which will say this image has a car, person, or animal. So this is the image is the X and Y is the label attached to it. Using this 1,000 X and Y data, I will train a neural network which will learn to predict what is contained in any image, whether it's a car, person, or animal. Okay, this is what we call as an artificial neural network, and I call it a divide and conquer strategy. So this problem would be hard to solve with classic machine learning, just with one equation like this. It can be solved theoretically, but the accuracy of the model will be low. But it can be solved with neural network. So I call it a divide and conquer strategy. I've added so many neurons and layers which will divide, and together they'll conquer this problem. Okay, I hope you understand what is a neural network now, as opposed to a classic machine learning model. Okay, let's continue here. Okay, let me proceed forward. So we discussed AI, machine learning, and deep learning. If I were to put them all in one diagram, so earlier I had rules-based system, traditional data analytics. Then I came up with classic machine learning, where we hand design features and we learn the mapping from X to Y, right? Mapping, this is Y and this is X, right? We learn the mapping from X to Y. Then we got to slightly more sophisticated mapping and we started getting into deep learning world. Okay, here features are auto-discovered. We don't have to hand design features. And finally, I got to neural network, which we refer to as deep learning. Why deep learning? Because it is deep neural network with many neural layers. So that's why we use the term deep learning, because it's a deep neural network. So here we detect simple features first, then the subsequent layers detect more abstract or higher level features, and then we find the relationship to the output Y. So the problem statement is same, the treatment or the solution is more sophisticated. Okay, and the gray parts are those which are being learned from data. Okay, the feature mapping is being learned from data. In case of deep learning, we are learning the features themselves. Okay, so features is a slightly abstract concept. In case of an image, the initial features are pixels, but internally within the layers, the features become internal, you know, calculations. Okay, they are not like terms we can name. Let me continue here. So as we discussed, AI is the overall area of making machine. Machine learning is a branch of AI which uses data science algorithms to train AI. Deep learning is a more specialized form of machine learning, and it uses artificial neural networks. Why deep learning is becoming popular in last few years? Because we have availability of big data. So a lot of data is available, which is useful for deep learning applications. And also we have cheap computation power. The prices of graphic processing unit chips or GPU chips has fallen. So because deep learning needs lots of matrix multiplication, it needs high performance computing systems. And with fall in prices of high performance chips, we are able to do deep learning. So between the hardware innovations and the big data availability, we are able to do deep learning now. Okay, neural networks could be done in old times also, but now they are more easily done because we have big data and we also have high computation chips. Any questions so far? Okay, you can feel free to interrupt me, ask any questions if you have any query. I'll repeat it if I have to. All right, let's continue here. So some examples are shown here. So AI, machine learning, deep learning have amazing applications. So some of them are shown here. So for example, a speech recognition chatbot, right? So I need a previous voice recording. I need the digital transcript So which is a digital transcript of the voice recording, and I can train a speech recognition chatbot. It will convert speech to text. Okay. Historical market data and future market data. So last year's stock prices, last month's stock prices. Last year's stock prices is the X. Last month's stock price is the Y. I can train a trading bot which can take automatic sell and buy triggers on the stock market. Photograph, photo captioning application, photographs in Facebook, a caption attached to each photo. For example, this photo has my dog Barley. Okay. And I can train an automatic image captioning or image tagging application. This is what Facebook also does. Okay. Sometimes it will suggest a caption for your photo because it has already trained its image captioning application on thousands of user photos. Face recognition. So face and attached name, you can train a face recognition model. Okay. store transaction details in a retail store, was the transaction found to be fraudulent historically, I can train a future fraud detection model. So like this, there are thousands and thousands of interesting applications. And these are called supervised machine learning because input X and output Y is available. In some cases, output Y is not available. This is called unsupervised learning. But we won't go there for the purposes of this session. Okay. So supervised learning is slightly simpler and the more common form so far. Okay. So let me just stick to supervised learning for this webinar. Let me continue here. So some more examples are given here. So Microsoft had a project in a state of Andhra Pradesh, which is a state in eastern India or southern India. And here using Azure machine learning, they were able to advise the farmers when to sow the seed. So when the farmer sows the seed in the soil can actually influence the yield of your crop. So using these predictive analytics, the farmers were able to increase the yield of the crop by 30%. Okay. And because it is able to predict, model can predict when it will rain, when should you sow the seed, and how much is the moisture in the soil, and so on. Diabetic retinopathy. So Google is working with the eye hospital in some hospitals of South India, like Arvind Eye Hospital, Shankar Netralay, where we can detect diabetic retinopathy using computer vision scan. So diabetic retinopathy, what happens that there are blood vessels on the retina wall of the eye. When the blood vessels formation happens due to diabetic conditions of the patient, so person loses eyesight because light cannot pass through a retina which has been infected with blood vessels. So we can detect early diabetic retinopathy for diabetic patients using computer vision eye scans. Okay, we can also do video verification of using SignZ. Okay, so basically you can verify the signature using video signatures and so on. So there are like tons and tons of interesting applications. Let me see if there's a question here. Could you please explain the difference between supervised and unsupervised learning? Okay. So as I told you, supervised learning refers to those situations where I have the output level Y available for an input X. Okay. So I can then train a model, whether through classic machine learning or deep learning, which finds the relationship between X and Y. And then using this found equation or found algorithm, I can predict future Y for any new input X, right? So the output of the model training process is this equation. Now let's say Y is not available. I'm only given X. So this is called supervised learning because the output level Y, the teacher Y was available. Okay. Now if the teacher Y is not available, the student has to learn on its own. Only X information is provided. For example, there's a news article which Associated Press generates, and a Yahoo newsfeed has to figure out whether this news article belongs to the sports section, the political section, or the entertainment section, right? Now this Y label is not available for this, so this news article is representing the X information, and a Yahoo newsfeed service has to figure out whether to place this article in sports section, the political section, or entertainment section of the Yahoo news portal, right? So this is called unsupervised learning because the Y information, the output label on this X, was never available. So it will do something called unsupervised learning, where it will try to detect this article is similar to other sports articles already detected. And if it is the case, it will place it in sports section. If it finds it has features similar to other entertainment articles, it will place it in the entertainment section, and so on. So here Y was never provided. Using looking just at the X, we are able to classify this news article belongs to sports, politics, or entertainment category. This is called unsupervised learning. It's an example of unsupervised learning. We call this clustering. So we are trying to assign X to its rightful cluster. Okay. This is one example of unsupervised learning. It's a big topic, so I'll leave it at that. Okay, let's continue here. Okay, so now let's look at some examples, some more examples. So Google image search. So you can enter an image and Google will find it, right? So it will use deep neural network to find other images similar to these images. Google Translate. Google Translate is able to translate among few dozen languages. And again, it is using X and Y information. So what would be X? Let's say X is English. Y is the French translation, right? So I'm able to train a model by looking at available data, English to French translation. And then I can do future translations from English to French. And I can train a model the other way around also. In this case, French language becomes X and English becomes the Y. So I have to train a reverse translation chatbot. So I can do forward translation or reverse translation. So this is the kind of technology that Google Translate uses. Okay. And it is embedded in the Android phones of Google as well, Google search engine as well. And Facebook uses DeepFace for tagging images, automatic image captioning. Baidu, which is a Chinese search engine, it uses deep speech, which can handle voice. It can understand voice inquiries in the Chinese language Mandarin. And then also we use it in pharmaceutical and predicting toxicity of drugs, right? And then predicting cancer and skin cancer and other kinds of cancers as well. So these neural networks find lots of mission critical or life critical uses, including healthcare, driverless car, right? And safety and security and so on. So you can see this is the input layer of the neurons. This is called the hidden neural layer and output, right? Now here we are showing three layers, 1, 2, 3. But in reality, I could have a deeper neural network. Now, as to how deep my neural network should be is left to the expertise of the data scientist. Okay. So if we find the model is not training well, the accuracy is low, we may add some more layers, right? We'll keep adding layers. This is one of the tuning steps we can do in our neural network to find more accurate models. Okay. So sometimes one hidden layer is sufficient. Sometimes we need more hidden layers. And these are all called hidden layers, the intermediate layers, because you only see the input and output, right? So that's why these intermediate layers are called hidden layers. And how many neurons per layer? Should it be 2 neurons or 3 neurons or 4 neurons? Is also a tuning parameter which the data scientist has to decide. There is no specific formula to find number of hidden layers or number of neurons in every layer. This is kind of a hit and trial for the most part. And sometimes it comes with experience, okay, or hit and trial mechanism. Let me continue here. So finally, if you try to define technically what is an ANN, it is a computing system made up of a number of simple, highly connected processing elements which process information by their dynamic state response to external inputs. So these are inputs going here, right? So these are input features. Right, these are input features, and all neurons in the previous layer are connected to all neurons in the next layer. If you can notice, this is called a fully connected network or a dense network. What is a fully connected network? All the previous neurons are all connected to all the subsequent neurons. There are other specialized networks where this is not the case. So that can be something called CNN and RNN. They are specialized neural networks where not all the previous neurons are connected to all subsequent neurons, okay? So it can get quite intricate. There are a lot of variations of the artificial neural network, okay? And the signal flows like this. And how a neural network learns? So it predicts something, right? So when I'm training the model, and then I also know the correct value, y known. So y known and the predicted value of y. So what we do, all that we have to do, just like what we do in classic machine learning, we compare how far y predicted is from y known. If this is not zero, that means prediction is not matching the known output. This error is backpropagated in my neural network. Okay. So I backpropagate the error. The word we use is backpropagation. So this is called forward propagation of the signal. This is called backward propagation of the error. Okay. So information passes forward but the error passes backward. We use something called gradient descent learning, which I won't get to in this webinar, but basically it represents the error and the rate of change of error with respect to weights. So there are weights here everywhere. There are weights here everywhere. W1, W2, W3, W4, right? There are weights here everywhere. W5. So earlier we saw a simple, in classic machine learning, we saw something like this. There was only one weight, or W1, W2, two weights. All these lines represent weights for me. So there are so many weights. So you can imagine how many weights it has to learn, right? How many weights it has to learn. The expression is same. The expression is something like this only for every neuron. Only X and Y keep changing. Okay, only X and Y keep changing. For this neuron, the X is this, this, and this. For this neuron, the X is this, 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 this. So a neural layer becomes input to the next neural layer. Okay, so this is an output of all these X's here, and this is an output of all these X's here. So next layer depends on the value of the previous layer. Okay, so X and Y keep changing as we move forward in forward propagation pass, and the error is back propagating, and the weights get adjusted. The way this machine learning happens, these weights are adjusted when the error is back propagated, so that when it back propagates the error, then it forward propagates again. Again, it back propagates the remaining error, again it forward propagates again. This loop continues and continues and continues and continues till YP starts matching YK. When the predicted value of output neuron starts matching the known value of output label, then we can stop iterating. Otherwise, this model iterates probably thousands of times till the predicted value of output neurons matches the known value of output neurons. So there is a forward propagation loop, there is a backward propagation loop, and this iterative process can happen potentially thousands or tens of thousands of times till predicted value of output neuron matches the known value of output. Okay, this is how we train a neural network. Okay, I'm not getting into mathematical technicalities here, which will come in subsequent webinars, because this is just an introduction to deep learning and neural networks. Okay, let me see any questions here. Is the check of how close the predicted value was to actual value inbuilt in the process of using ANN? Okay, so that is up to us as a data scientist to decide what degree of error we are going to tolerate. Okay, so let's say Y predicted is, 95% of Y known. So we may take a subjective decision that 95% model accuracy is sufficient. Okay, machine learning is generally an approximate science. We typically cannot get to 100%, or we even don't want to get to 100%, because it leads to the problem of overfitting. So we accept a compromise. We say, well, 95% accuracy is good enough for me. So what percentage of accuracy is good enough for you is based on the problem statement and the subject matter expert. In case of trying to predict cancer, I may want to get to foolproof accuracy close to 100%. But when I'm trying to recommend t-shirts on Amazon.com website, I can accept, let's say, 80% accuracy also, because nobody is going to die if I recommend the wrong t-shirt, right? In case of cancer, I can take wrong diagnosis and then life-threatening decision. So I need foolproof accuracy. In case of recommending t-shirts on Amazon website, I can live with 80% accuracy also. It depends on the subject matter expertise of the data scientist, okay, and the problem statement we are dealing with. Okay, another question came, is there a scale to sensitivity of a match when you say YP? So, this is all subjective. How much accurate can it be? It's always percentage accuracy, right? We always talk in standardized accuracy scores, which are typically represented in percentage. Is our model 80% accurate, 90% accurate? So a scale can be anything. scale can be, you know, in fractions or millions. That's a different matter. Point is how much percent it's accurate. So there are various kinds of accuracy metrics we use in machine learning. I won't get into that. So accuracy score is a common one, but there are other ways of measuring the accuracy of a machine learning model. Okay, so I'll leave it at that for now. Let me continue here. So we saw a neural network. This is a 5-layer neural network. Now, sometimes some scientists may not count as the input layer as a neural layer, in which case this neural network will set to have 4 layers, right? But some data scientists may also argue that even the input neurons constitute a neural layer, in which case it will be a 5-layer neural network. Whether this is a 4-layer neural network or a 5-layer neural network is just semantics, is based on whom you talk to. Okay, that doesn't matter much. I'm just telling you a sideline note here that it can be considered a 4-layer neural network or a 5-layer neural network, depending on whether we consider the input neural layer as a valid neural layer, yes or no. Okay, let's continue here. So now, as you can see, I'm showing you a 4-layer neural network, and the actually 3 hidden layers are shown. One, so this is a face recognition neural network. So first layer of neurons is detecting edges in the face. The second is concatenating the features and like eye, mouth, chin, and so on. And the third layer is detecting the complete face, and finally it is outputting the full face. Okay, so this can be considered a 4-layer neural network. The input neurons are not shown here, which would be the pixels in the image. Okay, so we are only showing 4 layers. So in this case, we are saying we are not counting input neurons as a neural layer. Okay, let me continue. Okay, I want to discuss a very important point now, which we have not discussed so far. So let me take a slight step back here. So let's look at classic machine learning again. So there are samples given to us here. Yeah. Okay, these are data samples. Each a sample is represented by an X and Y value. Let's say this is the house price, and this X represents the area of the house, the size of the house, right? The area of the house, or in square meters or whatever. And then Y represents the price of the house. And I'm given historical house price information like this. So when I'm doing classic machine learning, I'm trying to find the line fit. What do I mean by line fit? I'm trying to find the equation of the line which satisfies these blue dots, okay? So given these historical data points, I'm trying to decipher or reverse engineer the relationship between X and Y. Basically, what I'm doing, I'm trying to find the ideal weights. This is called regression or a line fit process. It's a traditional data science technique, which is also used in machine learning regression algorithms. Okay, that's where the overlap between data science and machine learning happens, because we use the same algos which are coming from data science world. Okay, so this is called regression. And if I was trying to find, let's say, the line which satisfies, which segregates two classes, right? Is this image containing a person or an animal? So there are two classes, person class, animal class. So when I try to find the equation of this line which segregates two classes, this is called classification, right? So the difference between regression and classification is somewhat small, because in both cases I am trying to find the equation of the line. In regression, I am trying to find the line which fits the line, which fits the samples. In classification, I am trying to find the segregation line, the line which segregates the two classes, right? So that leads me to classification set of algorithms. Now, let's say the relationship between X and Y. So let's say if I were to represent in a different way. So this is a relationship between X and Y, correct? So I'm able to find the equation of the line which represents the difference, mapping from X to Y, right? This is classic regression or classic machine learning. But what if now I gave you a very complex relation? Let's say the relationship between X and Y is very loopy or complicated, if you will. I'm calling it loopy, but we can also call it complicated. Let's say the relationship between X and Y is very, very complex. Okay. This is where deep learning helps. So deep learning comes steps into the picture when classic machine learning fails to find, you know, a good relation, the relationship between X and Y. See, if it is a somewhat linear model, I can find a linear model, a linear equation between X and Y. But if it is such a non-linear model, this is called non-linear because it's very curvature line. So then I need the power of neural networks. So why, how neural networks technically work? What neural networks do? They break this line into tiny infinitesimal nearly linear segments. Okay. So what I am actually doing in a neural network, I'm telling you a very deep insight about neural network now. What I am doing, I'm taking a very complex relationship between X and Y, breaking it into tiny infinitesimal line segments. Okay. And each line segment is represented by a pair of neurons. So these two represents one line segment here. The next line segment is represented by these two neural layers. And the next line segment is represented by these two neural layers. So when I cannot find a straight line between X and Y, I break the problem. That's why I call it divide and conquer. I divide the complex relationship into lots of nearly linear line segment relationships. And then I'm able to find the Y for this X. And I can find the Y for this X. And for this X, I can find this Y, right? So if I were to break a non-linear line, so I just try to find this Y for this X. Then I find the second neural layer, and here the input is this one for this one. And then this becomes input for the next one. And then this becomes input for the next one. This becomes input for the next one, and so on. This is exactly what we are doing in a neural network. We are breaking a complex non-linear relationship between input and Y, X and Y, and the subsequent neural layers are discovering the line segment relationships. Okay, so we keep adding layers till we arrive at nearly linear relationships between consecutive neural layers. This is the intuition behind a neural network and why it is successful in discovering a complex relationship. So I found all these line segment relationships. Each line segment relationship is represented by consecutive neural layers. And then all I have to do, I combine them together, which I am doing here, in totality, these relations now solve my overall relationship between X and Y. Okay. I hope you understand the intuition why a neural network is successful now. Okay. There is a question here. Is it correct to assume that deep learning will need nth degree polynomial where n will likely be greater than 3? So that's a slightly technical question. I'll answer that. Okay. So let's say the relationship between X and Y is simply this. Okay. So this is X, this is Y. You can clearly see this is not a linear relationship, right? This is what we call as a 2-degree polynomial. So the learned model will look something like, so there's a second 2-degree polynomial, second order degree polynomial, right? This can be learned with polynomial regression. I don't need deep learning. Okay, how about if I go more complex? This is a third degree polynomial. The equation of this kind of model will look like y is equal to, let's say, 3 to x to the power of 3. And what about this? This is a fourth degree polynomial. Here it might be something like y some value y w x to the power of 4. So as long as it is simple polynomial, clean polynomial, we can use traditional regression to find the relationship. But what if it is haphazard, right? This is the relationship between X and Y. What if the graph is haphazard? This you cannot find with even polynomial regression. You have to break it into different neural layers and use a deep neural network to find a very haphazard, complicated relationship. See, detecting face in an image is a very complicated determination, and hence it needs a neural network. A 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 degree polynomial will not solve it. Okay, it is very haphazard because these pixel features are very, very random compared to the output determination that it concerns a human face versus an animal. Okay, so I hope you understand what we are saying here. All right, let's continue here. Okay, so why deep learning? I think we already covered this sort of. So there were some innovations by done by Professor Lee Kuhn and few other great data scientists of the world, and that's why deep learning broke out. Another reason is the availability of data, and it allows us to train complex AI with lots of data, which came around with big data availability in Hadoop systems or database RDBMS systems or social media or IoT sensors and so on, right? And then we also have cheaper hardware. The prices of GPUs from the companies like AMD or Intel, AMD and NVIDIA have fallen quite a lot. And now our home computers have GPUs. Earlier, GPUs were so expensive, you could not afford them in your home computer. Now all of our home computers have GPUs. GPUs were always more powerful computation units compared to CPUs, okay? Which was that traditional chip used in home laptops or desktops. Okay, only supercomputers had GPUs. Now even home computers have GPUs. Now even mobile phones are coming to the power of where they are able to do basic machine learning on the edge. Okay, even mobile smartphones are beginning to do machine learning on the edge because their chips are becoming more powerful. All right, let's continue here. Okay, so some common types of artificial neural networks. The basic term is ANN. Then something called CNN, which specializes in image processing, right, or object detection in images. Then there is something called recurrent neural networks, which are used for time series, for example, predicting stock prices based on historical stock prices, right? And then the deep neural network simply refers to neural networks having deep layers, lots of layers, right? If it is more than one hidden layer, we typically call it a deep neural network. But however, if you have only one hidden layer, we basically sometimes we don't call it a deep neural network. It has only one hidden layer. As I said, number of hidden layers have to be increased if the relationship is complex and accuracy is not coming out to be good. Then you have to keep adding layers till you can find an accurate model. And there's something called deep neural network as well. So there are various architectures. So there's convolution, DBN, RNN, GANs, generative adversarial network. And they find users in computer vision, speech recognition, NLP, natural language processing, audio, bioinformatics, and so on. Okay. So there is a huge area, and you can spend years learning these systems. Okay. So that was our technical part of our webinar. Any questions before I go to some career counseling points? Okay, you can ask me any questions if you have any. Okay, let me continue with some career points here. So as I said, we are an AI training and AI research company. So I'll just talk about the market here. So there is huge demand for AI and ML engineers and data scientists. There's simply not enough talent available anywhere in the world, okay? In India alone, they say there are right now 50,000 data scientist positions open. There is not trained staff. Why? Because it takes a steep learning curve to train an ML engineer. That is the problem. This area of machine learning and deep learning is not so simple like Java or mobile development or web development or project management. This is a pretty complex area because it involves applied mathematics, right? And a lot of us have to refresh our mathematics since we have forgotten maths after our college days or engineering days. So in our courses, we start with a maths refresher first. But basically, machine learning is nothing but applied mathematics. It's a branch of applied mathematics. We use a lot of mathematical algorithms to train the models, okay? It's basically maths. So there's a steep learning curve. It takes about 6 months to 1 year to train an intermediate level machine learning expert, 6 months to 1 year minimum. And that's why there is shortage of talent, and the university courses were simply not aligned with this kind of curriculum, right? There are very few professors who teach AI in the world. Okay. So because it was not so common so far. So if you want to be in AI and data science area, there are various kinds of career tracks you can follow. You can also be a non-programming AI specialist. We call it an AI consultant or AI specialist. You still have to learn the algorithms like regression, decision tree, or neural networks. But you can skip the programming of it in Python or R. But if you are able to do programming or have done programming in your historical past, or at least in your college days, I would recommend the technical data science track, technical ML track. And within technical track also, there are various kinds of careers which are possible, right? We can do Tableau-based visualization solutions, SPSS, Cognos, SAS. We can be a big data developer in Hadoop, Spark, Kafka, Hive. But the most glamorous, the most sophisticated, and the most exciting area is AI, which has machine learning and deep learning. So my company and my startup primarily deals only with AI. We don't deal with big data and reporting and visualization using Tableau. We will deal only with machine learning, deep learning. And it is such a big area, it will take the rest of our lifetime to just tackle AI. It's so huge. Within AI, you can specialize in predictive modeling, computer vision, text, speech, and NLP, natural language processing, robotics, driverless cars, reinforcement learning, healthcare, and so on. It's a huge area. So you can specialize in different branches of artificial intelligence or different applications of AI in various industries. Okay. Now, if you are not don't want to do programming because you come from a management or a non-programming background, you can choose to specialize in AI as a consultant or specialist, and all kinds of people like sales and marketing consultants, program management, project management, QA, HR folks, and tech marketing as well can train themselves in AI. Because we believe that going forward, careers will require specialization, not generalization. You cannot be a general technical marketing manager. You will be trained as an AI marketing manager or as an AI HR manager. So I believe the future belongs to specialists, not generalists. The era of general professionals is over. Okay. That's why most of the MBA programs are also adapting their curriculum to new areas like AI, data science, business analytics, and so on. And they're teaching specialized courses, even MBA programs. Okay. Even commerce graduates are trying to learn data science and AI, because even in financial services and commerce, it's all about AI and machine learning now. Okay, so these hopefully this gives you an idea of possible career paths in this area. Let me continue here. So as I said, we are an AI training company, a leading company from India, but we train folks globally. We have students in multiple countries of the world who take our, all of our programs can be done online from anywhere in the world. The first course we offer is machine learning. The second course is deep learning with TensorFlow. And the third program is the AI internship program in our AI lab. We run a very sophisticated AI lab in Bangalore, where we meet every Saturday. And our remote members join our AI lab sessions through online Google Hangout or go to webinar. Okay. And then we also have a research program called Research Fellowship. It's a very advanced program where you have to publish international research papers in leading AI journals like Archive or IEEE or Springer or whatnot, and speak in international level conferences. Okay. So the first three courses anybody can do. The final one is by selection. We take an interview for research fellow, because here the requirement is very stringent. You have to publish international research paper, which is not easy. Anybody can do the first three courses. The integrated program with first three courses is called Postgraduate Certificate in Artificial Intelligence and Machine Learning. Okay. You can take individual courses or you can take the integrated program. If you already know ML, you can start with deep learning and AI internship. If you already know ML and DL, you can do the AI internship directly. If you do all three programs, we will also issue a postgraduate certificate. Okay. So this is almost a 6 months program, by the way. The whole thing takes about 6 months to finish. It's an online program, and you can also join our Saturday lab meetings in person in Bengaluru or Delhi, or through Google Hangout if you are in a remote other locations or across the world. Okay, so this is the program we have. All the details can be found on our website, or you can reach out to me. I can discuss one-on-one with you. Okay. So this is the curriculum for our machine learning course. As you can see, we start with maths refresher, because most of us have forgotten maths, as we were saying before. We have to start refreshing our maths, basic linear algebra, vectors, matrices, probability, a bit of calculus, you know, and all that. So this is required for machine learning because all the algos are mathematical in nature. We can also provide an optional Python refresher course if you want to refresh your Python. But if you have done any programming in Java, C, C++, PHP, Visual Basic, or React JS, Node.js, you'll be fine. You can pick up Python directly. It's an object-oriented interpreted language like Java, but it's much, much simpler than Java. Looking at the code, you'll be able to figure out if you have done programming in your lifetime. Okay? And then we go to all these algorithms like regression, classification, decision tree, support vector machines, and so on. Okay? And our deep learning track is this one. So the right half here represents the deep learning track. The left half represents the ML track body. The right half represents the deep learning track. The deep learning, the prerequisite is you should do ML first. If you know ML, then you can do the deep learning course. Here we teach artificial neural networks, convolutional neural networks, RNNs or recurrent neural networks, and so on, and a bit of introduction to GANs or generative modeling, RL, reinforcement learning, autoencoders also. Yes. So it can take up to 4 to 6 months just doing these two courses if you are doing in a part-time mode. If you are in full-time mode, then you can get it done faster. Okay, and then after deep learning comes the AI internship in our AI lab, where you are required to do projects with us in the lab and present the projects to our lab community through seminar or webinar formats. Okay. Any questions so far? Okay, let's continue here. So let me show you some AI lab work which we do. So these are some of the projects we are working on in AI lab. Our AI interns and lab researchers are working on dozens of AI projects in computer vision, generative modeling, NLP, RL, and so on, driverless cars. So you can see some of these projects here. And this is the dense pose algorithm, which is a pose extraction algorithm. It's a very advanced computer vision algorithm to extract human pose from this football video. And then we can use it for analyzing the player performance or the game performance. And we can also use it for training our sports teams. So these kind of pose extraction algorithms can be used for augmented virtual reality applications, driverless car or self-driving vehicles, cinematography and motion picture, generating video ads, or gaming or fashion design and animation systems and so on, right? So even Amazon.com, Amazon uses pose extraction algorithm for its e-commerce website, okay? Let's continue here. Okay, so this is object detection. So here you can see I'm trying to identify the products on the retail shelf, and I'm assigning a probability or a confidence score. So here I'm saying in the top right that this is a Sprite can and with a confidence percentage of 99% or 90% or whatever. So these kind of object detection models can be used in smart retail or cashierless stores, manufacturing, shipping, supply chain, FMCG, traffic management, and so on. So there are like thousands and thousands of areas where we can use computer vision object detection. We use convolutional neural networks and its variations here to detect objects in videos and photos. So this is our next AI lab session. If you happen to be in Bengaluru or Noida, you can join our AI lab, or Delhi NCR or Bengaluru, you can join our upcoming lab this Saturday. Okay. And you can check out what we do in the AI lab. You can find all the details on our meetup page where you found this webinar. And you'll also find our future webinars on the same page. Okay. So any questions before I go to some solution demos? Any questions you have? Our address in Bangalore, typically we operate out of, in Bangalore, typically we run the AI lab and we work in Embassy Tech Village on Outer Ring Road, Belandur area, okay? But we also run it in Hebal. sometimes we also run it in Hebbal. Okay. Periodically, we also run our AI lab in Hebbal, which is North Bangalore community. Okay. Any other questions? So on the screen, you are seeing my contact information. I'm available all the time. You can WhatsApp me or call me, and we can discuss your individual aspiration and what you want to do, what kind of courses you want to do, or you want to do research in our AI lab and so on. Okay, it will be a pleasure to have you in our community or as a student. Any other questions? Okay, let me start some demos now. Meanwhile, you can keep asking your questions through the Q&A window. Let me show you a face detection model. I'm sure most of you have seen the Friends soap from America, and it's a very popular long-running serial. And here we are using open computer vision, OpenCV protocol, and specifically within OpenCV we are using the deep neural network API of the OpenCV to do face detection on the Friends TV serial characters. Okay. And it is running at a certain FPS of frames per second. So if the speed of the video changes, we have to retrain the model. Okay. So this is face detection from a video. This was trained by one of our lab researchers. Okay. Let me show you a few more. Also only show you pose extraction, which we spoke about before. So you can see a video here, right? So if I were to do pose extraction on this video, let me just increase my voice again. If I apply dense pose algorithm, this is what I get. So we have extracted just the pose. Obviously the sound is gone for that dancer Bruno Mars. And now we can use it for automatic ad creation, motion pictures, e-commerce, fashion, animation, video games, and so on. Like the dozens of industries which can use such kind of algorithms. I can superimpose myself and I could become this dancer. Unfortunately, that creates what we call as a deep fake video. So such technologies, unfortunately, can be used by malicious minded people also. They are generally ahead in tech adoption, as we know. So here I'll show you a driverless car use case. So I'm using something called image segmentation algorithm to color the road pixels as green colors. Okay. So I have trained this model on something called Kitty Roads dataset. And such kind of models are used in a driverless vehicle to visualize the scene in front of it at any point of time. It's a mobile vehicle, so it's moving. So I'm taking snapshots of the current image and trying to predict where is the road in the view so that the driverless car can make sure it sticks to the road and doesn't veer off to the grassways or the pavement. And also, if there's another car or person on the road, we'll mark it in a different color so the driverless car can avoid the obstacles on the road. Okay, so this is called image segmentation model. It again uses advanced computer vision. Let me show you some NLP stuff, natural language processing. So here I am trying to extract certain named entities. I'm trying to extract location, time, person from a textual note. I'm trying to extract different kind of entities. This is called NER or named entity recognition. Okay, this is one kind of natural language processing application. Okay. All right. You can do text summarization also. Text summarization, where we can summarize a long form text into a short form text. For example, when I'm doing business reporting to my CEO. The CEO doesn't have time to read long form text, so I can automatically summarize the text. In pharmaceutical literature, we have long pharma documents, pharmaceutical research, so we can summarize it using text summarization algorithm. Okay. In healthcare, we have so many applications, detecting breast cancers or analyzing radiological images for tumors and so on. And here also we are doing, from a pharmaceutical text, I'm trying to predict the name of the disease. So here, reactive hypermia is the name of the disease contained in this pharmaceutical literature. We train a model which starts recognizing how to extract the disease names from a pharmaceutical text. There are lots of other healthcare applications like text summarizer or language translation for vernacular needs, or clinical decision support system to assist a doctor, automatic dictation by a doctor, or named entity extraction, and lots more. Okay, so hopefully this gives you an idea of some of the projects we do in the AI lab. So by the time you reach our AI internship program, you have to do many of these projects and present them in our lab. If you are in Bangalore or Delhi, you can present in person. If you are abroad or in other cities, you can present through webinars. Okay. Okay, let me see. Any healthcare example? I think I showed you a couple of healthcare examples just now, right? Any other questions? Okay, so okay, I don't see any other questions. So thanks for joining today. I hope to see you in future webinars. Have a good day or good night, as the case may be. I'll see you next time.